So hey guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We're here at the O2 Arena in London with the one and only Wolfgang Van Halen. How are you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Look, this lineup of these shows is fantastic. I mean,
awesome.
It's killer just to see you on there, but these shows, you've got to be getting a kick out of playing these shows in Europe with these bands. How have they been so far?
Oh, it's been amazing, man. I'm sad that this is the last show. You know, I've been friends with everybody in Hailstorm and Alter Bridge for over 10 years. So to tour like one big happy family is really cool.
And of course, you know, finally to get, you know, that new music, which all of a sudden now doesn't feel like it's that new. So much time has passed. It's been 2 years since the first single, you know, just about.
It's been what, June is when it came out? So it's been a year and a half-ish.
But for the audiences in Europe and UK to finally get to hear it live after, you know, cancellations of tours and
so
what have you.
About that. I'm so happy to finally actually be out here. It feels really great. And everybody's been so amazing. Like, we're the first opener and the crowds have been so receptive to us. It's been really, really a great experience.
Awesome. And has there been any surprises, you know, in taking these songs out in front of these audiences, you know, tracks that have sort of created a life of their own, or any changes to the set that you wouldn't have expected?
I'm just really surprised to see people singing the lyrics. Like, it's crazy. It's our first time here and it's not even our show, and to see so many people singing and knowing all the lyrics to all the songs is crazy to me.
Yeah, of course. No, it's got to be a real kick. And of course, you know, putting out the music, reaction from the fans, the time passes, you play these shows, but then very, very quickly there's a demand for some new music. Now, I know you have given some hints that some new music is coming. Mm-hmm. You know, you've been in the studio. You know, how is that coming along, and when are we going to get to hear it?
Soon, definitely next year. Before I left for this tour, I was in the studio for about a month and a half. Mm-hmm. And recording. We got pretty much most of the recording done, except like guitar solos and vocals and stuff like that. So I have to go home now and try and relax just for like a little bit for the holidays, and then go right into it for a month. And by February, I'll have a whole new second Mammoth album ready to be released at some point next year.
You got a title in mind?
Nah, not yet.
No.
I'll figure it out.
What about the, you know, even number of songs? You got like a final track list even, you know?
I mean, we don't even have final track names yet, so.
Wow. So it's still very much happening. And what's particularly interesting with yourself and unique, many things unique, but one in particular is that normally the second album is that sort of difficult second release for you. The first, that was really the first one, you know, because there must have been so much pressure. We talked about this before, of course, you know, about the fan expectation and all that sort of stuff. Are you in that unique position where the second album is actually a little less full of pressure, a little less expectation, allowing you to do what you want?
Oh, yeah, it feels like it's just a creative playground. I think the first album was more of like a, what is this, and kind of figuring out what the project was and who I was as my own artist and songwriter. But now that I know, you know, it's taken a quarter of the time, and I think the music is even better.
That's awesome. Well, we can't wait to hear that, that's for sure. Now, tell me, Wolf, like, where does, because so much music's been around you ever since you before you can even remember, but talking about what you can remember, like, what was the first thing that, like, music wise that you remember inspiring you, that made you feel like, this is what I want to do? Like, was there a piece of music that you heard? Was there an instrument, tone?
No, it just kind of happened. I mean, I've, like you said, I've just been around it my whole life, that before I knew it, like, I was learning drums at 9, picking up the guitar at 12. I remember when I was like a toddler or something, like, my dad saw me like tapping my foot or something to like in time to a song. He was like, yes, he has rhythm.
Yeah.
I think growing up in the environment, I've been always been around it, so it just like it just seemed like the natural order of things.
And has it always been that way for you, that, you know, you know, because you obviously put in some amount of work for, you know, in terms of unbelievable pressures of things that you've got to learn on the spot and be ready to do it. And you know, right up until, you know, even the Taylor show, you know, the pressures that which we've got to talk a little bit about. But you know, was there ever you know, a time where anything has been a struggle for you to learn? You know, do you remember pieces of music or techniques or stuff that was just like, fuck, I'm never gonna get through this thing, like, why is this part so challenging for me?
I think it's just, it just comes down to practice, you know. There's a lot of people say to me, and I know it's meant as a compliment, so I'm like, oh, it's, you know, in your genes and stuff, and it's like, no, it's like I've been playing for half my life.
Yeah.
and I practice a lot, like, I understand it's a compliment where it's coming from, but yeah, it's just kind of that sort of 10,000 hour rule, if you will.
Yeah.
It's like you put enough time to something and you begin to see results.
Well, that's it. You know, you put the time, you structure the practice, you practice the right thing. I mean, it's similar to someone in the gym and their gym splits or whatever, you know, like doing, you know, I'm going to do this for that day and do that thing for that day. So how would that split be for you for practice? Like, what was a Wolf Van Halen, you know, weekly practice session looking like when you were sort of cutting your teeth?
Yeah, I mean, growing up, it was always just, I'm a drummer first, so it was kind of just finding whatever songs I was into at the time and just trying to play them perfectly. You know, if it was, I mean, growing up when I started playing drums, it was like I had Van Halen Best Of Volume 1 and Enema of the State by Blink-182, and right. I tried to learn both of those albums front to back.
That was cool.
And then from there, I remembered when I got older and I started trying to play to Tool songs on the drums, that's when I noticed, like, first it was like impossible. Like I didn't know how to do it. But then after just practice, you start to get more comfortable with it and you notice an improvement.
Yeah, you know, no, definitely. And you know, the way that you write, I mean, the songs on, like I said, we've spoken before, I mean, I absolutely love the debut record, can't wait to hear some more stuff. But in terms of like the way that you write and your inspiration for writing, is that those early inspirations for you and those feelings that you get being moved by music, is that still what informs you with your writing to this very day?
Yeah, that was a big thing with this second album, talking to my producer, Elvis Basquette. He was like, look, you know, you can't even focus on the fact that people liked what you already put out, because that will start to like negatively inform how you, the creative process.
Sure.
It's like, what we need to do is just do what we did the first time, which is just to keep creating music that interests you and excites you.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what we did with this one. And we've have some really exciting songs that feel like an evolution of the first album.
Oh man, you're like a tease. You're a tease. I bet you've got some stuff with you as well. There'll be stuff on the phone, you know. But this Elvis guy, man, like, talk to us about him, because this guy all of a sudden has become like the Brian Eno of
amazing.
Modern rock.
Not only is
he
just an amazing, hilarious, kind man, but he's also an incredibly talented musician. And he feels like, In the case of Mammoth, you know, because it's just me, he's like, he feels like the other half of the band in the studio. You know,
that's cool. Yeah, and you can trust him.
Exactly, he's that other ear that if I'm doubting myself or if I'm not sure what I'm doing, he's that other person that kind of bounce stuff off of, and if I'm going in the right direction and stuff like that.
Yeah, killer. Now, I won't press you anymore on your record, but just one final question on it, because obviously there's, you know, it could just be you on the whole record, you know, it could be you on every single record, but there's also space, I think, for guest guys every now and then, you know. I mean, could we ever see, you know, maybe, you know, Alex playing some drums on a track, you know, or on this record, or a future record?
It depends. I think I would probably have more fun with it. Like everybody would always assume that, like, oh, Dad would probably be on a song, but if he was, I wouldn't want him playing guitar. I'd want him like
That's cool.
playing cello or something. So maybe if Al does end up being on a song, I'd want him to like play piano or something. You know, something that just isn't what you think it would be.
That's cool. That's very cool. Yeah, and you maybe wouldn't even tell anyone for like
exactly
20
yeah.
years. Yeah, I think that's very cool. So you know, big part of what you do, of course, is play incredible live performances, which we're going to be checking out tonight. Can't wait to see it. You've been road testing some very interesting instruments over the last sort of 12 to 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
talk us through what that process is like in terms of like sort of woodshedding these guitars, you know, fine tuning them before the release. What are some of the things that you've discovered along the way?
Well, when we started Mammoth, the thing I first off wanted to do is to make sure I had my own sound and I wasn't just duplicating my dad's or somebody else's sound. And I found that semi-hollow guitars really spoke to me when it came to the material. So that's something that the EVH brand doesn't offer. So it was a fun thing to try and merge, you know, the classiness of a semi-hollow with sort of the performance grade guitars that that the brand is known for. So it's kind of that marriage of both of those, and it's been really fun to try and tighten it up. And you know, we're messing with the pickups. Maybe, you know, they're a little bit hotter than classic pickups, mm-hmm. and you know, just finding the right everything down to just to the name and the headstock. It's really fun to be dialing it in. And I think we finally we're working on some new bodies that are sort of the 2.0. Like they're easier to put together for, you know, for development purposes and stuff. It's just fun to. It's going to be cool. I'm excited. So hopefully by the next run in the States with Alter Bridge, I should have some prettier new guitars to look
and
at.
And I do love all the little, you know, hidden details. Well, they're not. They're in hiding in plain sight, of course, you know, but, you know, like the E-hole, for instance, mm-hmm. you know, and the letters that are sort of the shape of it. You know, it's nice when there's a story behind it. It's not just, oh, I just, you know, carved out something random.
Exactly.
You know, but was there any major changes, you know, along the way? You were like, oh wow, I thought this was going to work, but actually now that pickup's too hot or that neck's too fat, or
not really. It's really just been sort of a just kind of following the steps. Like we knew what we've wanted, and it's just kind of chipping away at it until we get like the perfect thing, and I think we're almost there.
So you say almost there. Now 126 is coming around. You know, could that be a date that we? No, not going to be ready for that.
It's not ready yet, but it will be soon. You know, it's
maybe NAMM.
I don't want to rush it out. Okay. You know, we want to get it down perfectly. So
that makes sense.
I'm not even going to say a date to get people.
You know, I want to get my hands on it. You know what I mean? So
it will come out though. I'll guarantee that.
And what about further down the line? Because obviously, you know, you got fantastic gear from guitar all the way through to pedals and amplifiers. You know, could we see a signature pedal down the line, or, you know, a tweak to the amplifier?
Possible, but you know, right now it's like the stuff we have is so great, man. I'm just using a stock 5156 L6, you know, all the pedals that we have. It's like
it's a pretty good lineup, isn't it?
You know, all I mean, you need, really.
Do you change anything up for the Euro shows than you would on the
no
US?
Other than that, it's just depending on what songs we're doing and what effects I need. Well, although, you know, nothing I've recorded yet is really effect dependent. It's just kind of like what I want to do for fun.
Yeah.
except for a couple solos.
You still use all that gear like that when you're in the studio, you know? You're not shifted to, you know, Kempers.
Oh, no. I use the real stuff.
I couldn't imagine that would be too much of your bag. Not that it's
I totally understand the convenience of it all, but I don't know. To me, it just feels wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, you've got some
nothing
nice,
against the people using it, but just for me, it's I just prefer to.
If you've got the tools there, you've got, you know, you got a pretty good studio set up there as well. You know what I mean? So you know, it's why do all that? Something that I find particularly interesting is your relationship on social media with a lot of the fans and stuff, which I personally get a massive kick out of now. Very recently, you know, Joe Bonamassa, you know, he stepped away from social media due to, you know, just not, you know, in his own words, basically feeling like he can't really control how he responds.
It's gotten really shitty.
It's a bit shitty.
It's gotten a lot worse in the past year.
And anyone who's like of a, you know, like you know, I'm trying to use my words carefully here, but most of us can see who's on the right and who's on the wrong in these interactions.
It's always, social media in general at its core is just terrible and brings out the worst of everyone and humanity as a whole, but it's noticeably gotten a lot worse in the past year.
You've just walked that line so well, I think, because so much pressure has been on you. Every other comment on social media is about, oh, your dad meant this much to me, and all that stuff must...
And it's awesome. It's awesome to see.
Of course it is, but it's also kind of irrelevant to you as a musician and what you're putting out at the moment if you're going to be a fan of what you're doing.
But I totally understand where people are coming from. Dad left such a mark on the world, and I love to see it. But, when it comes to socials and stuff, it's just it's a fun line to walk, because you gotta, I don't know, because I find that people being straight up like mean don't bother me. It's really people who are really clueless and kind of don't understand what they're doing. The other day there's like a fan group on Facebook who are run by really awesome people, and somebody wrote something like, Mammoth opens for nobody, like making a really like cocky statement on our behalf.
Right.
And there's tons of people in the comments going like, that's a really selfish thing to say, Wolf. And it's like, that's not me. I had to jump in there and be like, yeah, except for, you know, all the times we have opened for people and all the times we will continue to do so. And so, you just got to kind of just pop the negativity out of there. And it's always helpful to, that's the stuff that bothers me, is when people attempt to, because it's very easy on social media to misinform people, or take something that you said out of context to be used against you.
That's it.
So it's, I just like to, clear shit up.
That's why I've just been really impressed with it, because it's so easy to get, I guess it's just your personality, but occasionally, even sometimes with certain personalities or comedians or whatever, sometimes there's certain people, they can get away with saying a certain thing, and you just know they're a little bit Teflon in a way, because it's like they handled it so well at the beginning that it's kind of like, oh, that's them just being them. And the social media thing seems to be this conundrum that artists, particularly I think because egos get in the way so much, and you just come across as such a modest guy, a guy who is just happy to be.
I'm a good actor. I'm really an asshole.
And a great actor as well, clearly. But either way, it's I think it's one that I brought up Joe Bonamassa in particular, but for other artists to look at, this is how you do social media. You don't take it too seriously.
No, the way you do it is you avoid it completely. Really, the only reason I do it is because I'm obligated to, just because it's a part of the job to kind of,
promote.
It's a great way to connect with fans.
You like it.
I think that at its core is where I get the most enjoyment from, is connecting with people.
Of course.
Because that never existed before. Yeah. But everything else, it sucks.
Now, we would be remiss to not talk a little about this insane show that you were part of, an incredible tribute to a great talent. Something I've got to say, I congratulated you the last time we spoke on just, dealing with the pressures of putting out an incredible record, but I really have got to congratulate you on this in particular, having basically the biggest balls in music to go and step out and do that, because this thing must have nearly not happened right up until the last minute.
Yeah, I didn't know if I'd be able to do it. Dave had reached out to me and we started talking about it, he brought up, he's like, do you think maybe you'd want to like play a couple Van Halen songs? And I was like, maybe, but it's still, I don't really talk about it. I don't really listen to Van Halen anymore. It's difficult for me. Yeah. Like I'm not there yet. He was like, take a week and think about it and hit me back. And I really thought about it hard. It just seemed like if there was any time to do it, it was that time.
Yeah.
It's not something I ever want to do with Mammoth. This is what the band is, and we're gonna do that. I'm not using Van Halen to prop my own career up.
No.
I'm here to to perform my own music that I write. That's what Mammoth is about. But when it came to respecting a drummer who was one of my favorite drummers of all time and such an amazing man, to play music from one of his favorite bands and to honor my father at the same time, that's just like, it's a of course I'm gonna do that.
And that's why I've got to describe it in that way, because the pressure must have been immense to, you know, and it's not something that, you know, anyone can sort of take lightly in any way.
My uncle can attest to that. I was going nuts before the Wembley show. I've never been in a place with that many people, let alone on the stage playing for that many people. Yeah. So
Yeah, you must have to switch off at some point during that process, because you think about it too much, you just have a panic attack.
Yeah, you reach like a fight or flight sort of thing.
Because, and of course, you know, I don't need to explain it to you, but you know, with so many eyes and ears, people judging it, you know, is he going to play it like this? Is he going to play it wrong? How many fucking bad performances of your dad's music has there been? And you know, I mean, you know what you've got, but you know,
if there's going to be anybody as hypercritical to anybody on anything, it'll be me on that. Like, people will have every right to tear me apart. But
not to hang on it too much, but I mean, you know, that had to be pretty cathartic, you know, like
just alone being able to perform with such incredible musicians that I have looked up to my whole life, Justin, Dave, and Josh. To jam with them was an incredible experience alone, but let alone for what it was for. And the response it got, I never could have expected that. I don't think I've ever seen such a wave of unfiltered positivity for me on the internet at any time in my entire life.
Yeah. You know, I mean, congratulations. It was an incredible moment. And, you know, just one final thing on it is the positivity, because that's the thing. Growing up, and you remember yourself, it used to be, you know, every other week there'd be something cool in guitar happening. Oh, did you hear that new solo by this guy? Did you hear so-and-so played with this person? This person showed up here. It doesn't happen as much these days for one reason or the next. So that being like one of those cool guitar moments that got the guitar world talking.
Oh, dude, that blew me away seeing, like on the year-end issue of Guitar World, like so many guitar players I looked up to were like, the guitar moment of the year was that.
100%,
crazy, man. Yeah, I can't believe it.
It's killer. So we got Christmas coming up. What's a Van Halen Christmas like?
Sleep. Yeah, I plan on going home and aggressively doing nothing.
Aggressively sleeping?
Yes. having a consistent internet connection will be very exciting. I'm excited to, because I play a lot of online video games. Yeah. Having a consistent internet connection that is over at least 20 megabytes will be wonderful. I'm very excited.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned the games. I mean, what were you playing just now?
I have my PlayStation out with me, and I'm trying to beat God of War Ragnarok before I get inevitably spoiled on the internet. Another wonderful thing about the internet, people like to spoil things for you. I play Apex Legends a lot with our guitar player Frank. We play all the time.
And if you're ever playing online, would you give out your handle?
I feel like I have like a personal one, and one that I have made that if I ever wanted to stream or something, I would.
I could see you doing Twitch streams.
Yeah, it feels a little weird, but you know, maybe it'd be worth doing, you know, on some downtime. But I remember
cool.
I did a Facebook Live, an Instagram Live one time, and it was so uncomfortable and so weird to be like, there's 1,000 people just like in my phone looking at me right now as I figure this out. It's weird.
Well, you did say to me before, you know, that you weren't super comfortable in this, you know,
I'm never comfortable.
But you seem like to have fallen into it quite. Is it just one of, have you just forced yourself, or are you just feeling more?
It's a direct result of past me's actions. Like, I like to say, whenever I'm in the middle of something and I have to worry about it later, it's like, oh, that's a problem for future Wolfie.
Okay.
And me wanting to do this album and sing and everything is a problem because I'm not a very social person, but now I have to be a front man in a band because of my own stupid actions.
Yeah.
But while it's completely against how my personality normally is, it's really warmed me up, and it's been a really fun experience to kind of work on that and fill this new role. It's I feel like if you're not challenging yourself, you're not growing.
Yeah. If you're not just about to drown, then you've not gone deep enough.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah,
I like that.
Yeah. Just to circle back a little bit to the game stuff, I did want to ask you, you know, do you find you get, you know, influenced by other media, you know, being films or games or in terms of your songwriting? Does that ever sort of spark anything in you?
Not directly, but just inspired in general by just amazing composers and musicians and stuff like that. But nothing really directly. I think still. That most of that inspiration lies from like musicians I'm a huge fan of, like Dave Grohl or Trent Reznor and stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, I appreciate how much gaming is being more mainstream, because it is another form of art, and I think it's nice to see that people are beginning to respect that instead of it just being like the nerdy thing.
Absolutely, you know? No, it totally is. And you mentioned Trent there, of course, he's gone down the route now of, you know, incredible soundtracks as well as superb Nine Inch Nails records. Mm-hmm. You know, could that, do you think that would be anything you would do in the future, like an instrumental sort of album? Or
maybe. You know, I still have a lot of work I'd like to do with Mammoth and building what that is, but I never say never.
I just want it all from you, Wolf. You know what I mean? Like, I want it all now. You know, like, you mentioned the instrumental stuff, and of course the other side of the sort of Guitar Hero genre, you know, you've got your Steve Vai, your Joe Satriani's, your Zach Wiles, and all that, you know, and they do these G3 shows, they do Generation X. Now, I know in the past, when I've spoken to Joe Satriani, you know, his number one with a bullet guy for G3 was your dad. You know, he wanted them on there, he wouldn't entertain him. You know, he's gonna cry forever for that Satch. But you know, is that something you think, like, if you got a call to do that, would you be in any way interested to get up on stage with these guys?
I really don't know. It's just like how it wasn't dad's vibe, it's not really my vibe.
But you're a different guy, you know what I mean?
I don't know. It's not my thing. One, I feel like I'm not even good enough to participate in something like that. But two, it just I don't know. Again, I'd never say never. But
yeah, that's cool. That's cool. And how was the Grammys? How was it being a part of that?
That was wicked. So talk about a fish out of water. I did not feel like I belonged there in any capacity. But it was an honor to be there, man. It was a crazy experience. I couldn't believe it.
See, it's so nice when you see that, because every now and then there's a, you know, an artist where you feel like it's like you're there on our behalf, you know what I mean, like one of the fans, like you could see pictures of you, you know, with certain people or what have you. You almost, you can put yourself in your position as if like that must be fucking weird.
It was really fucking weird. But it was amazing, man. Like I was nominated in a category with songwriters and bands I've listened to my whole life. I lost to one of my favorite bands. Like, that's cool shit. Like, that's really cool. But yeah, I'll never forget it. It was an amazing experience bringing my mom and my fiance and that guy over there. But yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, it's got to be. It's got to
really
be.
Really thankful.
You know, growing up, there has been, you know, a lot of incredibly talented people around you, you know, as we've talked about before, and there's got to have been some great songwriting advice that's come from time to time. But what I want to know is, what's some of the shit advice that you've got from some of these guys? Has there been anything that you've just
shit
heard?
Advice?
No, that didn't work.
I feel
out
like
well.
If anybody gave me shit advice, it would be like on purpose to sort of like ruin stuff. Yeah. But I don't know. I think I've been lucky enough to be surrounded by such amazing people that I haven't really gotten any shit advice.
Okay, well, what about the good stuff then?
Oh man, I think just being around this tour, especially just being around all these amazing songwriters and musicians. I had a little play date with Miles, where we got to sit down and hang out, and I showed him some of the new tunes, and we were just talking about it and our writing processes, and it was really interesting to see the way he attacks, you know, writing melodies and vocals. So I'm excited to kind of apply what we were talking about and how that's going to affect
awesome
writing vocals for me for this stuff.
Yeah, that's super exciting. Now, you know, obviously you and Mark go way back as well. You know, I saw you guys play a fantastic show in Camden. It must be 10, 12 years ago.
Literally now. 10 years ago. It was 2012.
Was it really?
Yeah.
Wow. And, you know, to come back on this bill, you know, at this venue, it's got to be pretty special. You know, do you ever just sort of pinch yourself?
Yeah,
you know?
it's full circle. It's really crazy to after all this time, to be here in this capacity. It's not lost on me. I'm very very thankful, very
would,
grateful
would,
to be.
Would
part
you
of
work
this.
With Mark again on if the call was there?
Yeah, if he needs me, of course. Yeah, you know, right now Mammoth is sort of my priority,
of
and
course.
I'm having a really good time building that. But again, I'd never say never.
And what do you? How do you feel about, like, because obviously he's got this, you know, Alter Bridge, you know, headlining tonight, but then Mark's going to be doing his solo show next door in a couple of days. Are you going to get a chance to see that?
I wish I could. If yeah. I wasn't going, if I wasn't, you know, directly going home like tomorrow morning,
yeah.
I absolutely would stay and watch that.
It's a tremendous
dude. I love
a
what
project,
he's doing.
It's it?
He has the perfect voice to it, which is so crazy. Like, you wouldn't expect that, but then you listen to his voice and it's like, oh yeah, he's freaking nailing it. It's amazing.
Well, the thing is, this is like another one of these ones about walking this fine line, mm-hmm. and how sometimes you can be, you know, too much one way or the other. And when I last spoke to Mark, you know, I was congratulating him on it, you know, because again, you hear this come out and you think, oh, what is this going to be? And then you find out what it's
and
for.
And then it's incredible.
You find out what it's for, and you think, oh, sorry, I can't say anything wrong.
I'll give it a chance,
and then,
it's perfect.
But, you know, it's, you know, I was saying to him, you know, if that had been Scott, they'd done it from Creed. You know what I mean? Like, that's just not... I'm sure it would sound great, but he's going to get ripped for that. You know what I mean? No matter what.
Man.
And it's like Mark is, you know, he's just hit it right out of the park, and I can't wait to hear it in a live set.
Yeah.
It's going to be...
Mark's a badass. I wish I could see it.
Yeah, it'll be real killer. Now, talking of live shows and the cancelled shows and what have you, fans tonight, they're going to get a little bit of a taste of what Mammoth has in store, but... going to be ready for some solo shows, that's for sure. So I know you get these big dates coming up with Metallica, that's going to keep you busy.
Crazy.
But we're going to see some solo UK shows.
Absolutely. I you know, there's nothing on the books currently, but I know we have a busy next year planned, so I wouldn't be surprised if we were going to be out here at some point, because I know the way Metallica tours is pretty crazy, the way that I think it's like two shows a week.
Yeah.
So we need to figure out how to connect the dots in between. So I'm sure, you know, I don't want to put the cart in front of the horse, but I'm sure we'll find some stuff.
I mean, they'll
be doing
two shows a week, and then they do a show, don't they? They do a show before they even get out on stage, so it'll be like four
yeah.
shows for them all the time.
Yeah.
Do you go way back with those guys?
Not really, actually. I met James in 2015.
Mm.
I was we were playing San Jose, yeah, and it was in the middle of the show. Ice Cream Man. Dave was doing Ice Cream Man, so it was when we all walked off stage. And when I walked off stage, my Uncle Pat was like, "Hey, meet James Hetfield." And I was like, "Hi." It was really crazy, and we just sat there and talked the whole time for about, you know, 10 minutes or 15 minutes, however long Dave was rambling that night. And he's a sweetheart, so I'm really excited to reconnect with him and see him. And then I was hanging out with Lars at the Taylor Hawkins tribute, and he's a great dude too, so honored that they invited us to be a part of it. You know, it's really crazy that, you know, if you look at the, it's a little bit confusing the way the dates are laid out, like with the asterisks on who's going to be there, but we're playing every single building.
Yeah.
So it's not every night, obviously it's two nights on each building, but we're going to be at every single building, which is
that's killer.
Crazy.
That's killer. And of course Kirk, you know, he's got Green A, you know, so you might want to have a little shot on that. I'm sure you've got some leverage that you could say, I could let you have a little shot on this if you want. If would you be interested in holding Greeny playing a few notes with it?
I mean, if he lets me. I mean, I'm.
I think
I'm
he's pretty
overall,
chill. He's pretty chill with it, I think, to be honest.
I'm just really excited to meet them, and I'm just grateful for the opportunity.
Yeah, killer. Look, Wolf, absolute pleasure to chat with you once again. Congratulations.
Likewise.
On everything.
Thank you.
And can't wait to see the show tonight. Have a good one.
Thank you so much.
Thanks,
man.
Thanks.